My presentation aims to highlight some critical aspects of this condition that emerge from investigation on patients and that may limit current approaches to the development of effective treatments. So Alzheimer's disease affects over 30 million people worldwide. Its incidence increases with age, and the overall prevalence is growing rapidly due to the aging of the population. The clinical picture is heterogeneous. Memory deficits are initial symptoms in most patients. However, there are non-amnestic presentation, including language dysfunction, visual spatial dysfunction, executive dysfunction, or other type of presentation, particularly in genetic forms. The molecular pathology of the disease is marked by misfolding and aggregation of amyloid beta in the extracellular space and protein tau in nerve cell bodies and processes. I have to underline that in many instances, other amyloid proteins are co-deposited in the brain of these people, including alpha-synuclein, TDP43, and cystatin C. The familial forms, which are rare forms, are linked to mutation of the precursor of the amyloid beta protein, or presenilin 1 or presenilin 2, which are the catalytic part of the gamma secretase that cleaves APP, so the amyloid precursor protein, to generate A-beta. Genetics plays a role also in sporadic forms of the disease, in which the major risk factor is the APOE epsilon 4 allele. This moiety binds to amyloid beta and affects A-beta clearance and aggregation. This is the picture in the end stage of Alzheimer's disease. As you see, all areas of cerebral cortex show large amount of amyloid deposits that can even be seen and counted by eye, if you want. And there is accumulation in the same areas of hyperphosphorylation tau in the forms of neurofibrillary tangles in neural cell bodies and processes, particularly in dystrophic neurons surrounding the amyloid plaques. The observation that mutation in amyloid precursor protein gene and presenilin result in increased production and aggregation of A-beta led to the A-beta cascade hypothesis, and which is the most widely accepted scenario. This hypothesis proposes that A-beta, which is a normal product of ATP processing, undergoes misfolding, or A-beta intermediates, particularly prone to aggregation, assemble into oligomers, high-order structures, so protofilaments and fibrils, and finally, in amyloid deposit, forming amyloid deposit that induce a reaction of astrocytes and particularly of microglial cells that sustain a chronic neuroinflammation. And all this leads to tau pathology and nerve cell degeneration. There are many arguments in favor of this hypothesis. I mentioned before the linkage between genetic forms and mutation in APP and presenilin 1 gene, but also the trisomy of APP, such in Down syndrome, leads to a full AD pathological pictures. Also a major risk factor for sporadic AD is APOE, which affects A-beta clearance. But there are also some factors against this hypothesis, including lack of correlation, close correlation between amyloid load and dementia, and the observation of frequent amyloid deposition without significant cognitive impairment among the elderly people. So most scientists think that additional events are required to cause neurodegeneration, and neuroinflammation can play a major role. In the last year, so in the last 25 years, many attempts have been done to model disease using particular TG mice to investigate disease pathogenesis, identify therapeutic targets, develop disease-modifying treatments. Over 200 TG mouse lines, mouse models have been generated in the last years. These models are very far, actually, from the real world. So many models are generated with overexpression of mutant APP, but many other models are double transgenic models with mutant APP and PS1. There are triple transgenic models with APP, PS1, and tau, and usually overexpressed tau is a mutant tau, which is not found in Alzheimer's disease, but is linked to frontotemporal dementia. So as you see, the translational value of this model is questionable, since they are highly manipulated, they do not reflect the real world. And many of these, or all of them, do not recapitulate central aspect of the disease. They can be useful to ask very specific questions, but not really to study the pathogenesis. Concerning the A-beta, so APP processing can follow two different pathways, non-amyloidogenic and the amyloidogenic pathway. In the amyloidogenic pathway, APP is cleared by beta and gamma secretase to generate A-beta peptides. The most studied peptides are A-beta 40 and A-beta 42. The 42 residue peptide is much more amyloidogenic than A-beta 40. However, there are many other species that are generated in the APP processing that have been neglected for many, many years, but may play a role in the disease process. We will see this in a minute. A-beta produced by APP processing, A-beta 42 particularly is highly amyloidogenic, and when you generate synthetic peptides of A-beta 40 and 42, these peptides readily assemble into oligomers and amyloid fibrils in vitro, so these are oligomers and amyloid fibrils. Solid-state NMR spectroscopy has been used to solve the structure of these A-beta 42 fibrils. The core of the fibrils consists of a dimer of A-beta 42 molecules per fibrid layer with residues 15 to 42, so the C-terminal two-thirds, which forms a double horseshoe-like cross-beta sheet entity, while residues 1 to 14 are partially ordered in a beta strand conformation. Concerning the second layer of AD, so microtubule-associated protein tau, this protein exists in six different isoforms that can be grouped into major families with three or four microtubule binding domain. Binding of tau to microtubules depends on its phosphorylation state. The tau has a large number of serine and threonine that can be phosphorylated, and in the disease state, tau undergoes hyperphosphorylation, misfolding, and aggregation into per-helical filaments and straight filaments, which disrupt the cytoskeleton. The structure of tau filaments has been investigated by cryo-EM, by the Cambridge group, and both PHF and straight filaments are composed by two identical protofilaments with C-shaped subunits, which adopt a combined cross-beta-beta-helix structure. The core of both protofilaments is composed only by a small part of tau, in particular the microtubule binding domain 3 and 4, and 10 amino acids C-terminal to the repeats, while the N-terminal and C-terminal termini of tau form a fascicle. I have to underline that this flanking region may play different roles also in the process. They can capture, for instance, monomers for elongation, mediate chaperone binding, mediate membrane binding in toxic assemblies. So these flanking parts are very important, although they are not fully investigated. The difference between parallel helical filaments and straight filaments is due to differences in their interprotofilament packing, which is symmetrical in PHF and is asymmetrical in straight filaments. And the ordered core defined the seed of aggregation of tau in Alzheimer's disease. A central issue to be addressed is the high phenotypic heterogeneity of AD. Alzheimer's disease is often seen as a single homogeneous pathological entity. Indeed, the disease is highly heterogeneous, and its complexity is a key issue to be addressed since it has important implication, particularly for the development of specific therapeutic agents. The clinical heterogeneity of sporadic forms of Alzheimer's disease is incorporated into the diagnostic criteria and reflects different brain regional distribution of the pathological process. In most instances, the presentation is amnestic, as I say, so in 15-20% of patients is non-amnestic. But this heterogeneity is even more pronounced, is remarkable, really, in genetic form associated with presenting mutation, which may present with cerebellar ataxia, for instance, or display spastic paraparesis or Parkinsonian syndrome. So, as you see, the clinical picture of Alzheimer's forms linked to presenting mutation is highly, highly variable. And this is an example of a young patient carrying the presenting mutation who had an initial ataxia syndrome and behavioral disturbances, and only in late stages of the disease appear a dementing condition. So, and neuropathology show a high involvement, a profound involvement of the cerebellum by A beta deposition, which is not a common feature of the disease. Also, heterogeneity is associated with APP mutation, which can be linked to classical AD phenotype in most instances, but can result in amyloid congophilic angiopathy with strokes, for instance, or a combination of the two. The clinical heterogeneity is paralleled by striking variation in A beta related neuropathological profiles, as shown by this panel, which highlights great differences in density, type, and distribution of A beta deposit in the cerebral cortex, for instance. So you can see in some instances a very important congophilic angiopathy, in other instances, almost absence of congophilic angiopathy, and this cotton wool plaque instead of dense plaque, and so on. So there is a huge variation in neuropathology. Understanding the molecular basis of phenotypic diversity has important implication for the development of treatment strategy. In the last part of my talk, I will focus on heterogeneity of A beta pathology and neuroinflammation. So I will make a case of A beta pathology and neuroinflammation. Robert Ticco and co-workers at NIH investigated possible correlation between A beta phenotype, Alzheimer's phenotype, and structural variation of A beta fibrils. They use extracts of cerebral cortex from three distinct subtypes of Alzheimer's disease: a typical form with long duration, a posterior cortical atrophy variant, and rapidly progressive form. The samples were used as a seed, and A beta 40 and 42 as substrate, and the fibers obtained by seed growth were analyzed by transmission electron microscopy and solid state NMR spectroscopy. Typical AD and also the posterior cortical atrophy variant show a specific predominant A-beta fiber structure, while rapidly progressing AD show a high proportion of additional A-beta fibry structures. So, and the authors conclude that variation in A-beta fibry structure may correlate with variation in AD phenotype, in analogy to distinct prion strains that are related to different conformers of PRP scraping. And indeed, prion disease are a prime example of how different conformers and assembly states of the same protein are associated with profoundly different clinical pathological phenotype. As you can see here, a classical form of Creutzfeldt-Jakob disease with a high involvement of the cerebral cortex and relatively sparing of the cerebellum, and the ataxic form with a high involvement of the cerebellum. And this form are associated with two different conformers of PRP scraping. My group investigated this issue with a different, more direct approach. Brain samples were collected from 24 patients with genetic and sporadic forms of Alzheimer's disease, and biochemical profiling of A-beta species in affected brain regions and purified amyloid fraction was performed using cell Dittoff mass spectrometry. And in addition, amyloid fraction were injected into transgenic mice to analyze the propagation pattern and amyloid pathology. As mentioned earlier, so a large number of A-beta peptide in addition to A-beta 40 and 42 are generated in APP processing, including a variety of N and C-terminal truncated fragments. Cell Dittoff mass spectroscopy show that amyloid fractions from different patients contain different A-beta species. And these fingerprint profiles could be clustered into three main groups, profile 1, 2, and 3. The profile 1 was found in about 70% of sporadic Alzheimer patients and in patients with presenilin mutation, where the predominant species appear to be A-beta 42 or N-terminal truncated A-beta 42 or modified A-beta 42 species. Profile 2 consisted in a combination of A-beta 40 and 42 and was found in about 30% of patients with sporadic AD. Profile 3 was found in familial AD linked to APP mutation and was characterized by A-beta 40 peptide and A-beta 138. So, in addition to this, there were a lot of minor species, as you can see here. It is well known that accumulation of A-beta in the brain is parallel by a reduction of A-beta peptide in CSF, in the cerebrospinal fluid. As a control, we then compare the A-beta profile in brain amyloid fraction and in the cerebrospinal fluid, and found exactly a mirror image supporting our result of the characterization of amyloid fraction. These four, three different A-beta profile show distinct chemical-physical properties in terms of resistance to protein escape digestion, as you can see here, aggregation kinetics, and syndic activity. And also, the different A-beta profiles show different propagation pattern in transgenic mice expressing the Swedish mutation, is a double mutation, just upstream the N-terminus of A-beta. These mice generate high amount of wild type A beta, and when injected with the different amyloid fractions, so belonging to different profiles, so there was a propagation pattern which was different, with major involvement of hippocampus and thalamus in some instances, only thalamus in others, only hippocampus in others, and also the topology of the amyloid deposition, vessel walls versus neuropil was different, and so on. Our findings are consistent with the results of Matthias Zucker group that used luminescent conjugate oligotiophanes to investigate the molecular architecture of amyloid deposits in brain tissue of Alzheimer patients, and found differences among genetic and sporadic Alzheimer subtype and between typical and sporadic AD and posterior cortical atrophy. And these differences, quite interesting, were maintained for translation to transgenic mice. Recently, we investigated the potential contribution of neuroinflammation to phenotypic diversity of AD. To this end, we carried out a neuropathological and biochemical study on brain tissue from 24 patients with sporadic and genetic forms of Alzheimer, and investigated the correlation between the neuroinflammatory molecules and the clinical pathological feature of the patient. This slide shows the neuropathological assessments of microglial cells were differently represented in familial versus sporadic AD patients with regard to morphology, distribution, and density. We then investigated whether these differences could be associated with differences in production of inflammatory factors. The study show high levels of these factors in AD sample respect to control, and a predominance of anti-inflammatory over pro-inflammatory cytokines in AD brains. The analytes were assigned to four biological classes: cytokines, chemokines, matrix metalloproteinase in innate immunity factors. And it, as you can see, the most represented classes were matrix metalloproteinase and innate immunity factors, suggesting a major contribution to neuroinflammation. Finally, we analyzed the association weight of the four cytokines families with available clinical, neuropathological, and biochemical data, and based on hierarchical cluster analysis of our AD cohort, the cohort was grouped in three neuroinflammatory clusters. Cluster one, characterized by patients with early stage at onset and death, an intense microglial reaction. Cluster two, patient with the fastest disease progression and highest amount of cytokines in A beta species. Cluster three, patient with longest disease duration and low neuroinflammatory profile in beta levels. So this cluster two was the most aggressive clinical phenotype, cluster three, the less severe clinical phenotype. And this is the last slide to summarize our view. So the phenotypic heterogeneity of AD is associated with differences in biochemical composition, chemical-physical properties, higher order aggregation pattern and targeting of A-beta species, differential involvement of microglia resulting in different neuroinflammatory profiles. These variables, along with other factors, contribute to the biomedical complexity of Alzheimer's disease and must be taken into account for patient stratification. The existence of molecular subgroups of AD can account for responders and non-responders to specific treatments, and has important implications for the development of disease-modifying therapies. Thank you for your attention.
Thanks a lot for a fantastic talk. Annette, do we have questions?
You're muted, Annette.
Ah.
Muted again. Yeah.
Okay.
I think there was something on the host. Yeah. Good. So I don't see any questions in the chat right now.
I have one question, if it's possible. Okay. So you mentioned on your last slide molecular subgroups. Is it? Could you specify what is? Is it a pure assembly of A beta monomers, or it is more complex subgroups?
So, I mean, this is a simplification. So I was referring to the A beta species involving amyloid deposition. We don't know yet which of these species really contribute to the amyloid itself, but I'm sure that there are assemblies of also the different peptide species in different, I mean, leading to different macromolecular structures. So, and this combined with also difference in neuroinflammation, so will result in different subgroup of patients. And I mean, as you know, so the main approach to therapy now is is immunotherapy with antibodies to specific species of A beta, specific assemblies, oligomers or fibrils and so on. But this is an oversimplification, since in most of these trials failed to date. Maybe now we have a compound which seems to be relatively effective in some patients, but this heterogeneity of response can be really related to the fact that Alzheimer's disease is not a single condition, but is a multiple condition with different molecular substrate.
So there are just a question from Christian Paul. Do you know if co-aggregating proteins might contribute to clustering? So I guess it's similar. Is it single proteins or is it a co-aggregation here?
And for sure, there is a co-aggregation of some of these peptides. For instance, in mutant, in genetic forms with mutation in APPs, there is a co-aggregation of A beta 38 and A beta 40, for instance. I mean, also this is still a preliminary picture, I think. So the things are much more complex.
So I have a question my own as well, because I'm curious on this take with the different polymorphic forms of the fibrils as well, and the indications of relation to the phenotypes as well. So I think it's more clear for the mutations.
Yeah.
Than for the actual different fibril forms, in my understanding, or what's your take on, on this?
Yes, I mean, in brain tissue of patient with mutation, this is more striking, but also sporadic AD is heterogeneous. So there are forms where amyloid protein contain the aggregates contain basically only 142 peptides, which can be full length or truncated at N-terminus, for instance, 342 or 1142 with pyroglutamate at position 3 or 11, while other types of sporadic AD at just A beta 40 peptides, so, or a combination of beta 40 and 42, so which, I mean, result in a very complex picture, so that has to be still defined in detail.
May I? Yeah.
Fabrizio. Final question, and then we move. Yeah. Go ahead.
There are some claims about some involvement of the heart in Alzheimer's disease, some damage of A beta to cardiomyocyte, and because you and Perriott are both present in the audience, it would be nice to have your comment about this.
But there is no evidence of involvement of the heart.
Yeah, well, some claims, some paper reporting some damage of and some systemic effect of A beta deposition, both in the brain and in the heart, which is your impression with your patient. So you don't see any really connection between the two diseases, or the disease and the brain disease and the heart.
In Alzheimer's disease, I don't see a connection actually.
Okay. I noticed Perry, yeah, go ahead.
Yeah, no, I don't see, sorry, my video is disabled, but no, I don't see any connection. And I think unfortunately there's a lot of confounders because you're dealing with an elderly population that are likely to have both diseases actually. And you certainly see progressive cognitive decline in patients with cardiac amyloidosis, but I'm not sure that's directly related to
what we're talking about. But my question is this progressive cognitive decline is associated with A beta pathology in the brain?
No, I don't think we have good evidence for that at all. No, I think it's more to do with a general disability.
Yeah. So
and frailty.
Also, probably the cardiac problem can affect. Brain function.
Yeah.
Okay.
The basis of this was discovery of A beta aggregate in the cardiomyocyte. In the heart. So I don't know if it's just a molecular observation or have some clinical implication. That's the point.